Get your praise on. Get your praise on.
Prophet David Taylor here on July 4th weekend. I hope everybody's having a safe and happy 4th, a safe and a prosperous 4th. You know, kind of the state of our country right now is probably something that we haven't seen in our lifetime. From my point of view, you know, I think this time now is like the 60s were for my dad and my dad's day. I think that 2020 is the 60s of the new millennium. You know, based on everything that I've read and based on the research I did, you know, I was part of a civil rights play with Dr. King back in 2009 and several of his contemporaries. And based on the research I did and based on things my dad told me, it seems like to me that 2020 is representative of the 60s, is the 60s of this generation. It's the 60s of this millennium. It's the 60s of this century, seems like to me. So it's been a very intense time. It's been a very difficult time. It's been a very trying time. But God is bringing us through. But God is bringing us through by faith. Okay, what do I mean by that? I mean that you have to believe. I'll get more into that when we get into the prophetic word. But God is bringing us through by faith. Okay, so I want to get into that so we can break that down. So again, I hope everybody's weekend is going well. I hope you're grilling or cooking or frying or whatever family or friends you can be around. I hope you're being around because many places are still in quarantine and some people are just ignoring quarantine. But so I hope it's been as safe and as fun and as happy as it could be for you and yours, given the situation. So let's jump into the prophetic word so we can hear what the Lord has to say. Now, please like and share this video. What I've been telling you lately is that when you come on and watch the video, you should watch from the beginning so you can be sure that you get all of the teaching, all of the scripture references, and so you can get all of the prophetic words. Remember, I tell you almost every week now, there are three levels of word. Okay, there's the Bible, which is the written word of God, which nobody in the Bible had, by the way. People in the new, what we call the New Testament, had the Old Testament scriptures, the Mosaic Law, and the prophets, but nobody in the Bible had the full completed canon scripture like we do. So there's the Bible, the written word of God. There is Jesus, the living word of God, the Logos, the word of God made flesh, the word of God in action, the word of God alive. And then there's the Rhema word of God, the fresh breathe right now in the moment coming fresh out of God's mouth that normally comes through the prophetic. You need all three. You need all three levels of word to try to prove and discern and work out what the perfect will of God is for you. You need to know the scriptures. You need to know the Lord personally for yourself. And you need to be in some type of prophetic flow. Because even in your personal relationship with Jesus, the Lord's not going to tell you everything. Some of it, because the Lord doesn't give no one person all the revelation. Okay? So you've got to be listening to someone apostolic and or someone prophetic so you can get that Rhema word as well. But plenty of pastors can flow in the prophetic too, because all believers are supposed to flow in the prophetic. Okay? So I'll tell you that just about every week now. So when a prophetic word goes forth from the Lord, please share it in as many places as you can. Please like and share this video because we want as many people as possible to have the opportunity to hear what the Lord is saying right now, okay? All right, let's say a word of prayer and we'll jump right on in. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, so much for your goodness and your kindness and your joy and your sweetness and your patience and your heart, oh God, and your hand of grace, oh God, and your hand of mercy. And you're just so good and you're pure. And we just can't thank you enough, oh God. And we just, I just don't have the words sometimes. My words would fail me for how much I praise you and I thank you. I magnify you. I glorify you. And I'm grateful to you, Father, for your goodness. Now, please forgive me for any sin. Wash me clean by the blood of Jesus that I might be clean and fill me with the Holy Ghost. Fill my mind, fill my mouth, fill my tongue, my teeth, my gestures. Fill me with the Spirit of God and use me and speak through me so that what you want said is what is said and what you want communicated is that which is communicated. So I must decrease that you might increase. I'm an empty vessel for your use. And I thank you for it is truly an honor to be used by you, O God, truly an honor, O God. And thank you for the opportunity, O God. And so we're looking forward to what you have to say today, because we know that you are a good God and true and righteous are thy judgments. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray, the Son of the true and the living God. Amen. All right. Amen and amen. Let's jump right in. Today's prophetic word is more. What'd you say? I see it. Today's prophetic word is more. M-O-R-E. More. More. What do I mean by that? What is the Spirit of God trying to say? Well, let's take a look at the scriptures and then we'll go from there. So what do I mean by that? Let's start with the scriptures. I want to start with Ephesians 3:20. This is a very familiar scripture, but we're going to look at it in a new light and some new ways and get some new things out of it. Okay? Ephesians 3:20. The book of Ephesians was a Pauline epistle, and that's a fancy way of saying a letter, because epistle means letter. It's a letter that the apostle Paul wrote to the church, to the saints that were in Ephesus, the city of Ephesus. That's why it's called Ephesians. Okay? And remember that the vast majority of what we call the New Testament is explaining the covenant that Jesus died to give us. Remember that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, what we call the Gospels, are not the New Testament. Everything that the Lord did is under the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, under the Mosaic Law. The New Testament does not start until Jesus dies. Okay? When the Lord died on the cross and shed his blood, that's when the veil in the temple was rent. And what that meant was that the way had been paved for us to get back in fellowship with Father God. That's actually when the New Testament started, because the Testament does not kick in until the death of the testator, just like when we write our last will and testament. It doesn't kick in until you die. So the New Testament does not actually start until the end of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when Jesus dies, just so you know. So everything that the Lord did, he actually did it under the Old Testament. Okay? But the New Testament that starts when Jesus dies and picks up after in the book of Acts, after the Lord ascends, and we have the day of Pentecost, the New Testament spends the vast majority of its time explaining the covenant that Jesus just died to give us. Okay? So with that in mind, let's look at Ephesians 3:20. Ephesians 3:20, I'm going to read several versions. I'm reading out of the Berean Study Bible. It says, "Now to him who is able to do infinitely more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us." New Living Translation, "Now all glory to God, who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think." Okay? King James Bible, "Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us." That's probably the version you're most familiar with. But we need to look behind the language to see what some of those words mean. So it says, "Now to him," let's talk about God, "who is able." Okay? That word, that phrase, "is able," coming out of the Greek, okay, dunamai, means I am powerful, I have the power, I am able, I can. So the Bible tells us that God is able, he's capable. What that means is that God has the power, he has the capacity to do what? To do infinitely or exceedingly abundantly. That word, that phrase, exceedingly abundantly or infinitely, that word is actually huper, and it means over, beyond, on behalf of, for the sake of, or concerning. It also means betterment, improvement, extending benefits. So what the scripture actually says is that God has the power, he's able to better us, to extend benefits, to move over and above and on behalf of us, more than all we ask or think, or more than all we request or petition or demand, or all that we can imagine to exercise our mind and write on the canvas of our minds, according to his power that is at work within us. Now, here's what we need to bring out here. because this is where so many Christians miss it. Okay? The place that, hey there, Sister Vanita, glad you made it. Amen and God bless. The place that the saints miss it the most is that they stop with just acknowledging that God has the power. That's great that God has the power, but I need that benefit that the scripture promises out here in my life. How do I get it in my life? Okay, God having the power is great, because remember I told you, the New Testament is a will. It's a will that Jesus left us. So think about if you had a rich relative and they died, and you found out that they left you some things in their will. Okay, what you'd want to do immediately is you want to try to figure out, how do I get that will to be enforced in my life? How do I get what they left me? How do I get it in my hands? Because it's good that they left it to me, but how do I access it? How do I get it? Because I need it in my life. This is where so many saints fall short. The answer to that question is you have to receive it and get it by faith. Now, that might be a phrase you've heard a million times, but you need a practical understanding of what that really means. Okay. There's such a thing as physical substances, and there's such a thing as spiritual substances. A physical substance is something like water or dirt or metal or fire. Those are physical substances. There's also such a thing as spiritual substances like hope. Hope is not physical. Hope is spiritual. Hope is something that lives in your heart. Hope is why you get out of bed in the morning, because if you didn't have any hope, then why would you get out of bed? Love is something that's not physical, but it's very, very real. Love is something that lives in your heart. Well, faith is a spiritual substance. In Hebrews 11:1, they talk about faith as a substance. Faith is a title deed. Faith is evidence, but faith is also a substance. Faith is a substance that you use to pull something from the invisible to the visible. That's how God made the world. The world out here that we see, he pulled it from the invisible to the visible. So because we're made in God's image, we have to act like God. When God wanted something, what did he do? He imagined it, then he said it. When God wanted light, he said, let there be light. When God wanted animals, he said, let the earth bring forth. When he wanted sea life, aquatic life, he said, let the waters and the oceans be filled with all manner of sea life. When he wanted fowls, aviary life, he said, let the skies be filled. He imagined what he wanted, and then he said it. Okay? That's the same thing we have to do. When you read God's promises, when it says he's able to do above all that you can ask or think, it doesn't mean stop imagining. It means imagine what it is that you want. And whatever promise you have from the Lord, you've got to pull it from the invisible to the visible by faith. You got to hear it like you're doing now. You got to believe it and receive it, but then you got to say it. You have to confess the same thing that God is saying. And then the next step is you have to add some works to your faith. But let me stop on that confession part. What I found out here is there's a whole nother level of that. And that is that on one level, you confess what you think and what you say, but on the next level, you let the Holy Ghost give you what to say. Because the Holy Ghost can give you what to say that's far beyond anything that you imagine. It's the most amazing thing. As you begin to pray in tongues and spend more time with the Lord and increase your faith, you will discover that the Spirit of God can begin to take over and give you what to confess. Because what you're confessing might be too small. Now, that's for somebody looking at me right now. Somebody looking at me right now or listening to me right now, the reason what you've been talking about hasn't manifested is because it's too small. And what the Spirit of God is trying to let you know through this prophetic word is that he's trying to give you more. He's trying to give you more than what you imagined. He's trying to give you more than what you thought. He's trying to give you more than you thought it was going to be. Okay? So you've got to take your prayer life, your prayer language, and your time with the Lord, and your time in the presence of the Holy Spirit, and let him take you to a new level. This is why, like I said at the beginning of this broadcast, this is why you got to spend time in the prophetic. You got to spend time around apostles and prophets, and you got to spend time around the apostolic and the prophetic, because as you are around people that flow in the apostolic and the prophetic, they will increase your knowledge, they will increase your faith, and being around them will help supercharge your spirit with that new level of anointing. How do we know that's true? Because it works that way with anything. When you're around people that are smarter than you, they supercharge your mind with more knowledge. When you're an athlete and you work out with people that are better than you, they make you push harder to make your body better. When you're trying to multiply your money and you hang out with people that have more money than you, they teach you how to what to do with your money, stuff you didn't know. Well, the same thing is true in the spirit. Excuse me. That's why, you have to hang around the apostolic and the prophetic. Because you're going to have to now allow the Holy Ghost to give you what to say. Because sometimes what we've been saying hasn't been the perfect will of God. Sometimes what we've been saying has been good or acceptable, but it hasn't been all that God has wanted to do. And so you're going to have to take your confession to the next level and let the Holy Ghost give you the words to say. Because what God has been trying to push through in your life is more than you were thinking, more than you were asking, more than you were saying. Okay? And remember, I told you the next step after that, you gotta believe it, you gotta receive it, you gotta say it, but you gotta let the Holy Ghost give you what to say. And then you have to add some works to your faith. Okay? What do I mean by works to your faith? For example, if God tells you to start a business, then you have to get a business name, you have to go on the government website and figure out what type of business entity you want, corporation, LLC, partnership, sole proprietorship. You got to open up a bank account, you got to name your business, you have to take some steps. The Holy Ghost is not going to do all that for you. Holy Ghost is not going to do all that. If God tells you to start a business, then even if God gives you the name, you're going to have to open the bank account and you're going to have to get your government number and you're going to have to do all that. You're going to have to put some works behind your faith. Okay? So when you hear the word prophesied or preached, like hearing it now, it's your job to believe it, receive it. That means believing it just means, yes, I believe that's true. Receiving it means, yes, that is mine that's talking to me. Then you got to confess it. You got to say it. But you have to ask the Holy Ghost, what should I be saying to be sure that what you're saying is in the perfect will of God? Because, you know, the scripture says that no man knows what's in him except the spirit that's in him. That means that nobody knows what's deep down inside of you except you. And obviously God, of course. But nobody knows your inner workings like you do. Okay? Well, the Bible says that just like you know, your spirit knows you. Well, the Holy Spirit knows God. Everything that's in the Father and the Son, the Spirit of God is the one who knows them. And so if what we're saying and doing is not the perfect will of God, the Holy Ghost has to give you what is the perfect will of God. Spirit of God, what should I be saying? What should I be confessing? And then once you find out what the perfect will of God is, then you put some works behind that faith. You act on what you have believed, received, and confessed. And that's how you get it out here, okay? And I'm talking about everything works that way. For example, if you've been praying about a spouse, a lot of people pray and ask God about a spouse, you have to ask the Holy Ghost, what should I be saying? What should I be looking for? What should I be expecting? Because if you don't ask the Holy Ghost, you can miss them completely. Did you know that? Did you know you could be praying for somebody to come in your life and you miss them completely? How do I know that's true? Because I know it's true in every other area of life. There are so many Christians that have missed the answer because your answer is walking around inside the body of somebody you don't talk to. It's because it's walking around inside the body and the mouth of somebody that you dismiss. It's because it's walking around in the body and the mouth of someone that you discount completely because you've already made up your mind how God has to answer you and who he has to answer you through. And it doesn't work that way. God can answer you any way he chooses. You have to stay open. That is how people miss Because remember, everybody that saw Jesus live, that saw God as a man, didn't believe. They didn't get it. Okay? So you got to believe it. Yes, I believe that's true. You got to receive it. Yes, I believe that's talking to me. You got to confess it. Spirit of God, what shall I be saying? And then you got to put some works behind your faith. That's how you get it out here. If you're trying to go back to school, if you're trying to buy some property, if you're trying to get work, we're going through the pandemic and you're trying to get work. If you're trying to have a child, if you're in some type of court battle, if you're dealing, whatever you're dealing with, that's how you get the victory that Jesus already died to give you, how you get it out here in your life. And that's why some saints have it and some saints don't. Some saints stop at the believing stage. They believe that God is able, but they don't receive it. They don't believe that that's it's talking to me. And then even if they believe it and even if they receive it, they don't say it. They're too scared to say it. They let the devil intimidate them, or they let people intimidate them, or here's another one. They let their mind get involved and they try to figure it out with their head. Okay, now you've heard me say this many times, but it bears repeating here. You can't figure God out with your head. Your head, your mind, your brain is not the interface that God gave us to deal with him. God gave us our brains to deal with this world out here that we live in. The interface that God gave us to deal with him is our spirits, this right here. See that? See that, how when you blow into your hand? What do you feel? You feel the breath of life inside of you. That's what God gave you. That's where the Holy Ghost lives, in your spirit. And that's what God gave you to deal with him. You can't fit it in here. And that's where a lot of Christians end up not getting their miracle. Because when the prophetic word of God goes forth, there's going to be signs and wonders and miracles following. And I declare it and decree it, and I release it over this word. For everybody that believes, receives, confesses by the Holy Ghost, and then adds some works to their faith, there's going to be signs. God's going to show you that that was him talking. There are going to be wonders. You're going to stand there with your mouth open and several other people. And there are going to be miracles, things that couldn't happen any other way but by the hand of God and the word of God. Okay? Believe what I'm saying. Receive it. Confess it and put some works behind it. Okay? Because the prophetic word comes with signs, wonders, and miracles. But the difference between Christians, some Christians stop at the believing stage. I believe God is able, but do you believe he's able for you? Some Christians, they say they receive it, but they won't say it. You got to say it. Why do you have to say it? Because that's what God did. God said, let there be light. The light didn't come forth until he said it. Okay? If that's the way God works, then that's the way we work. I don't know why that's so hard for people. If we're made in his image, and that's the way he made everything, by saying it, then we got to say it. Okay? And then finally, you got to put some works behind your faith. If you believe it, receive it, and you said it, then you got to act. Your choices every day have to line up with where you're going. Okay? But that's still not all. That's just the warm-up. Okay? Let me show you what the Holy Ghost showed me this week. Okay? I want you to turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 7. Now, when you come on this video, please like and share. Remember, I told you at the top of this video, whenever a prophetic word goes forth, we want as many people as possible to have access to the prophetic word of God, because you need all three. You need the Bible, the written word. You need a relationship with Jesus, the living word, the logos. And you need the prophetic word, the rhema word, what the Spirit of God is saying right now. Okay? Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 7. Deuteronomy is the fifth Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It's the fifth book in the Bible, starting at the Old Testament. It's the fifth book written by Moses, okay? Known by us as the Pentateuch, known by the Hebrews as the Torah, okay? And this is a very familiar scripture, but the Holy Ghost showed me something brand new. This is what I mean about why you need the rhema word, why you need the prophetic word, why you need to pray in tongues, why you need to be around apostolic and prophetic people, okay? Because that's what increases the spirits of God's ability to talk to you, okay? Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 7. Again, a very familiar scripture, but we're going to learn something new today. And there's going to be signs, wonders, and miracles following. Out of the Berean Study Bible, the Lord will cause the enemies who rise up against you to be defeated before you. They will march out against you in one direction, but flee from you in seven. New Living Translation. The Lord will conquer your enemies when they attack you. They will attack you from one direction, but they will scatter from you in seven. English Standard Version, the Lord will cause your enemies who rise against you to be defeated before you. They shall come out against you one way and flee before you seven ways. King James Bible, the Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. That number seven in the Hebrew is Sheba. Sheba, when you look it up in Strong's Exhaustive Concordance, that is number 7651. So you know I'm not just making this stuff up. Strong's Exhaustive Concordance, number 7651, Sheba or Sheba. That word there in English, seven, it means every possible combination with the number seven in it. 10,017, 1247, 777, 1777, 7700, 7500, 17, 27, 7000. It actually means that. Every possible combination of the number seven. Okay? And the Lord said, they come out against you one way, but they flee from before you in seven ways. So what the Holy Ghost told me this week was that so many of us have been claiming the double restoration blessing of Job. We have that little Christian-y phrase that we use called double for your trouble. God's going to give you double for your trouble. And where we get that, if you get it from Scripture, because some people just say stuff, okay? If you get it from Scripture, that comes from Job. I will, in fact, look that up so that you know I'm not just making that up. And so you have a scriptural reference, okay? It's in Job chapter 42, verse 10. Job, J-O-B, it looks like Job, but you pronounce it Job. That's in the Old Testament. It's not the first book in the Bible, but it's actually the oldest written book in the Bible, the book of Job. Job chapter 42, verse 10 says, "The Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he prayed for his friends, and the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before." Okay, the Holy Ghost showed me that's what some of us have been claiming. We've been claiming the double restoration blessing of Job. But what God has been trying to tell us is that he wants to give you seven times as much. Look at my fingers. Seven times. That just blew my mind. Okay, and I showed it to you in Scripture. That's why I use Scripture when I preach and teach and prophesy. So you know I'm not just making that up. So you know that the prophetic word has a root in the written word. Okay? So in other words, what the Holy Ghost was saying was that instead of confessing, like if you lost $1,000, you've been saying, "Well, Lord, give me twice as much, double for my trouble," and you're expecting $2,000. The Holy Ghost is trying to tell you, he's trying to give you $7,000. Right? That's what I'm trying to say. And it's completely scriptural. Okay? So now you've got to believe what you just heard me say. You got to believe it. You got to receive that God's talking to me. You got to believe and receive it by faith. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and he came down from heaven and came through the womb of Mary, you believe that by faith. If you believe he died on the cross for your sins, hung on the cross for 6 hours, died and rose again the third day, you believe that by faith because you weren't there. You didn't see it. So when I tell you that the Spirit of God is not trying to give you just twice as much, he's trying to give you seven times as much. You got to believe it. You got to receive it. You got to say it. And then you got to put some works behind your faith. Just think about it. Think about if you've lost some property and you've been claiming two properties. The Holy Ghost is trying to give you seven properties. Just think about that. Now, I know some people are going to say, "Well, what about my spouse? Is God trying to give me most spouses?" No. trying to give you seven wives, seven husbands. No. In Old Testament, that would have happened, but not now. What God is trying to give you is a relationship that's seven times better than any relationship you had. And if you're already married, God is trying to multiply the quality of your marriage by seven times. I want you to think about that. What if you got a good marriage and it's good? And God is trying to tell you, I'm trying to make it seven times better. Think about it. Think about every area of your marriage and think about being seven times better. The communication, the lovemaking, the money, the cooking, the travel, the parenting. Think about it. That's what the Holy Ghost is trying to tell you. So that's why we started out with Ephesians 3:20, that God is able. God doesn't have limits. That's one of the reasons God tells us to deal with him by faith. Because if you deal with him with anything with your mind or anything in a three-dimensional world, it's limited. That's why God said not to make a graven image. Because when you make a graven image, you make something that has height and width and depth. And you lock it into this physical world. And God said, that ain't me. There's nothing you could create with your hands that God says represents me. That's why the second commandment of the Ten is not to make a graven image. Okay? Because God doesn't have limits. You can't imagine what he is. If God were a house and you walked in him, you could go up in an elevator and never reach the top floor because there is no top floor. He's unlimited. See, that's what I'm saying. You can't make sense of God with your human mind. It's not going to happen. You got to receive it by faith. So Ephesians 3:20 tells us that God's able. He's able not just to give you two houses for the house you lost. He's able to give you seven houses, like Monopoly, except in real life. He's able. He's not only able, but he's willing, because we read it in Deuteronomy 28:7, that he wants to make your enemies get out your face seven times. So what that means, my brothers and my sisters, is that everything that the devil stole from you, as a matter of fact, you might want to make an inventory. Go all the way back to your childhood. Every single thing that the devil stole from you, God is trying to give it back to you seven times. Seven. Would you say, but what if my parents are dead? What if my mama's dead? What if my daddy's dead? Then God can give you a step-parent. God can give you a stepfather or a father figure. God can give you a mentor that's seven times better than your mom or your dad or God himself. Because the scripture says, when thy father and thy mother forsake thee, then the Lord will take me up. The Lord can step in and finish parenting you. And God can be a parent to you that's seven times better than the parent that you had. Can you see that? Seven times. I'm going to repeat my money example. If you lost $1,000 and you've been claiming double for your trouble, that means $2,000. The Holy Ghost is trying to give you $7,000. See, don't try to figure it out with your head. Don't try to make that make sense to you. Don't try to ask yourself how God is able. Just believe that he is, because God has never asked you to figure him out. Please find me that scripture. God has never asked you to figure him out. That's where Christians begin to short circuit their blessings, because there's actually a scripture that warns against limiting the Most High. When the children of Israel turned back against God and they limited, they started talking about what God could and couldn't do. Okay, we serve a God that raises the dead. We serve a God that can make entire galaxies and star clusters just because he said so. You do know that the Milky Way, the one we live in, is not the only galaxy that there is, right? You do know, right? There's Alpha Centauri, Andromeda. There's, you know, God can make entire galaxies and star clusters just because he says so. That's who you're dealing with. That's who you're attached to. Don't try to fit all that in your brain. You can't fit that in your brain. He never asked you to fit it in your brain. He asked you to believe. Use the substance he put in your spirit called faith. How do we know that's true? Because you do the same thing with another spiritual substance called love. When you get a new dog, what do? You open up your heart. If you've been with your spouse for a while and y'all go through something and you come out from it on the other side, you say things like, I love you more now than I did when we first got married. What happened? Your heart opened and your love increased. So don't tell me that you can't use a spiritual substance, because you do it every day. And don't tell me that it can't increase, because it does every day. Sometimes we've been in situations, because I know I've been in situations, where there are people that you never thought you could love them. And then God did a miracle in your heart and you find yourself having compassion and love for people that maybe you didn't even like. So don't tell me that it's not possible. It is possible, because he's able. He didn't ask you to be able. He said, believe that I'm able. But that's just step one. Believe it. But then you got to receive it. It's talking to me. Okay? That $7,000 is talking to you. So that means after you heard this word, if you don't get it, that's not on God and that's not on me. Because God is able, and I said what the Holy Ghost told me to say. That's on you. You got to believe it, and you got to receive it. That's talking to me. If you want to get married, you got to believe God's talking to me. He can bring the right person in my life. You got to receive that he's talking to me, that I can have a job. I can, if I've been out of work, I can work again because of the pandemic. That God is able to feed me, even in the wilderness, even in a dry place. God is able. He proved that in the scripture, because he fed Israel in a dry place. Okay? Believing it means I believe it's possible for him, but receiving it means he's going to do it for me. Then you got to say it, and like I told you before, you got to speak in tongues and ask the Holy Ghost to give you what to say, because some of y'all confession has been too small. That's why it hasn't happened. Some of y'all been saying, and you wonder why it hasn't manifested, because what you're saying is too small. That's a rhema word. That's something you can only get from the prophetic. That's something you can only get from the Holy Ghost, when God tells you, I've been trying to bless you, but all that what you've been saying is way smaller than what I had in mind. That's why it hasn't showed up. See, only the Holy Ghost can tell you something like that. And then you got to put some works behind your faith. You can't just confess and sit. You got to confess and act on what you've been saying. You understand? So I'm so excited. I've received this word. I believe this word. I've already seen manifestation in my life, because I keep telling you, when the prophetic word comes forth from the Spirit of God, okay, it's not me, it's not the prophet, it's not the vessel that God uses, it's the Holy Ghost speaking through someone. When the prophetic word comes from heaven, comes from the Holy Ghost, there will be signs and wonders and miracles following, okay? And I already experienced some of that this week. That's why I can tell you with confidence, okay, that it works. Because God is no respecter of person. If he did it for me, he'll do it for you. I've already seen some signs and wonders and miracles this week, okay, because of the prophetic word of seven, of more, that instead of just getting double for your trouble, he wants to give you seven times the payback. God is going to make the devil pay you back seven times. Seven times. I'm going to keep saying it. Seven times. Okay? And if the Holy Ghost even wants to increase that, remember I told you that word that's translated seven in English, in Deuteronomy 28:7, actually means every possible combination of the number seven. 1,700, 7,700, 7,777, 70. Okay? That's why you got to get it from the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, what should I be confessing? And then it'll live out here. Because you can't just walk around saying stuff that God didn't say. So many people are stuck on genie concept. So many people are stuck trying to make God do stuff, or trying to force God, or thinking that it's, you know, all abracadabra. And no, that's not it. You got to say what God says. You got to surrender your will to his will. You got to surrender your mouth to his mouth. You got to surrender your thoughts to his thoughts. Then the manifestation comes out here. Why? I'm going to tell you this a little bit and I'm going to be through. Why does it work that way? I'll tell you why. Because that's the way God gets the glory. That's why. Because that's the way God gets the glory. So many believers don't understand that part of being a Christian means You're going to have to face giants. A lot of saints don't want to face giants. You gonna have to face giants. Okay? Things, people, demons, and situations that are bigger than you. God is going to lead you to face giants. Why? So that when the victory is gotten, it will be clear that it's Him and not you. That's why. If you face something that was possible in your own strength, how could God possibly get any glory out of that? Because you're going to say that I did it. Look what I did. I figured my way out. I fought my way out. I thought my way out. I bought my way out. How does God get any glory from that? But God's going to lead you to situations. Got some giants in them. Again, things, demons, people, and situations that are bigger than you on purpose. Do you want an example from the Bible? Here it come right now. David and Goliath. Goliath was like 9 feet tall, okay? And he had a spear that weighed almost half a ton. Just a regular person couldn't lift it. That's what I mean. And all the trained warriors of Israel were scared of Goliath. And Goliath laughed at them soldiers for 40 days. He cursed at them, he spit at them, and Goliath called on his Philistine gods and laughed right in their face. And they didn't do nothing. You know why? Because they didn't have enough faith to believe that God was bigger than Goliath. So here come David, and what David did, he actually was bringing some lunch to his brothers on the front line, and his brothers rebuked him, like, what you doing here? Gave him all kind of attitude, and David was like, well, isn't there a reason? And then when David saw what Goliath was doing, David's faith rose up and said, that Philistine is not bigger than my God. Who is he, as a matter of fact, to defy the armies of the living God? Because that Philistine is not bigger than my God. And remember, before David went out there, he said it. Remember, he said, this day, God will deliver you into my hand and I'm going to cut your head off. Remember, he said it before he did it. And then David went out there and got a slingshot going and hit Goliath in the head. I stopped by to tell you, you can't throw a rock hard enough to hit somebody in the head and knock them out. It would have to be like a bullet that you shot from a gun. You obviously can kill somebody with a gun, but they didn't have guns back then. You can't take a rock and whip it around their head, no matter how strong you are, and throw it hard enough, because that rock sunk deep into Goliath's brain and killed him. It's because when David threw the rock, God's hand gave it a push. That's what killed Goliath. But David had to have the faith to do everything I just told you. Believe it, receive it, say it, and then act on it. That's what you have to do. Believe it, receive it, say what the Holy Ghost tells you to say, and then act on it. And then God gives the increase, and then God gives the victory. Because you gonna have to face something bigger than you. Get that in your head. If you are a Christian and you want the blessings of God Almighty, you gonna have to face something bigger than you. So stop running from that fight. Don't be like the armies of Israel that was out there trembling and nervous and wetting their pants and breaking out in hives when they saw, oh Lord, what we gonna do? That ain't, they stood out there for 40 days because they didn't have no faith. Until David stood up, until somebody stood up and said, I'm not looking at me, I'm looking at him. Okay, God delivered me from a lion with his bare hands. God delivered me from a bear with his bare hands. Can you fight a bear, a lion with your bare hands? So David already had experience with God giving him the victory over something bigger than him. And David said, that Philistine is not bigger than my God. Okay, that's what you got to say. That's the kind of courage and faith you have to have if you want God's blessing. That's the difference between Christians that receive and Christians that don't. By receive, I mean it shows up in your life. Okay? Now, I'm not going to get too personal, but I am going to say there's some stuff I can point to in my life that said there's no way that happened except that God did it. Do you have a testimony like that? I want to challenge you. Those of you that are looking at me and listening to me, I want to challenge you. Do you have a testimony like that? Do you have something in your life where you can say, no way that happened, but for the Lord? Okay, that is what God is looking for, so he can get the glory and you can get the blessing. That's the deal we have with God. He gets the glory, we get the blessing. Fine with me. I'm not arguing. I'm going to say yes, Lord, like a little child. And I'm going to let God be as good to me as he wants to be, because he wants to be better to me than I imagined. One more time. He wants to be better to me than I imagined. That means you're going to have to crucify your low self-esteem. You're going to have to stop looking at your righteousness and look at his righteousness and realize that we're righteous in Christ. Father God is looking at Jesus and he sees me in Jesus. I'm worthy in him. I'm not worthy because of me. But once you accept that he has conferred his righteousness on you, that's what gives you boldness and strength and faith to believe. Because you're not looking at yourself. You're looking at him. You see that? So from this day forward, I'm telling you that if you don't get these kinds of results, it's not because you didn't hear the word. Because I showed you in the scripture, and I showed you in the Hebrew and the Greek, and I told you about the Holy Ghost. That ain't God and that ain't me. If you don't get the results, that's on you. You got to believe it. You got to receive it. You got to say it. And then you got to act on what you say. All right? Amen and God bless you. You can tell I'm excited. I'm fired up because this has already been happening for me. Okay? Remember, I tell you, there's nothing I'm telling you that I'm not doing myself. I'm never out here just running my mouth. I'm talking about stuff happened to me this week. That's how I know it works. Okay? So amen. Praise God. Thank you so much. For those of you that tuned in and watched me live, thank you. For those of you that are watching the replay, thank you. To those of you that are watching rebroadcast. Now, I have a new format on YouTube. So the video there, the way you see me live here, the video looks different on YouTube than it does here on my Facebook Live page. On YouTube, I actually have the scriptures up as I'm talking. So I always put the link on my Facebook page and on my Twitter. So be sure to check out the YouTube video of this broadcast. So when you watch the replay, watch the YouTube video, you can see the scriptures actually on the screen, so you can see what I was looking at. Okay? My prophetic quarter three prophetic devotional should be ready. If it's not up there yet, let me know. You know, processing and whatnot, but should be ready because we're into quarter three. I just released a new hymn on Friday, because the first Friday of every month is a new music Friday for hymns, because I have my page, 150 hymns. I'm releasing a hymn for every song, okay? And then I have other music and stuff that I'm releasing. I'm working on this book I'm so excited about, but I can't tell you what it's about yet. But when you hear what it's about, you're going to want to advance order a copy. One more time. When I tell you what this book is about that I'm working on right now, you're going to pre-order a copy, okay? When I tell you what the Lord got me right now, okay? So check out the YouTube video, which should be up in a little while, because you got to fix it up and everything when you watch the replay. Hey there, Sister Sheila and Erica. God bless y'all. So good to see you. And thank you so much. Remember to like and share. Now, finally, if you want to sow into this ministry, you know that I don't do what I do for money. I do what I do because God has called me to do this. But if you'd like to sow into my ministry, many people have asked me, how can they sow? Because when any type of ministry, not just mine, any ministry that you listen to that's a blessing to you, you should sow in it. When you sow into my ministry, I told you before, it goes to help me with all my projects. All the projects that I'm giving birth to in the kingdom, my books, my music, everything God is having me do. So when you sow into my ministry, so you can sow on my Cash App. That's $DMT2, DMT, not the number two, but two capitalized. You can sow on my Zelle. ProphetDavidTaylor@gmail.com. You can sow on PayPal, Prophet David Taylor. But I'll put all those links on my Facebook page and on my Twitter. My Twitter is PDTSOTC, Prophet David Taylor, Shades of the Cross. That's the name of my band, by the way, Shades of the Cross. PDTSOTC. So if you'd like to bless or sow into my ministry, if this word has been a blessing to you, then definitely if you sow and bless me financially, it's helping me expand everything I'm doing in the kingdom. Okay? All right. Amen and God bless you. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thanks for everybody that watched me live. Thanks for everybody that shared the video. Thanks for everybody that's watching the replay. Thanks for everybody that's listening to me on the podcast, because I got this on video, live broadcast, podcast, all that stuff's on my website. Now, if you haven't been to my website is prophetdavidtaylor.org. prophetdavidtaylormyname.org. So everything I have is there. All my music, all my books, all my ministry, all my broadcasts, my podcast, everything. So you can check that out. Okay? Amen. And God bless you. I will be here this Thursday at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time for No More Genies. You know, my teaching on No More Genies is the second Thursday of every month at 7 p.m. I'll be doing a broadcast, and then I'll be back next Sunday, 2:30 p.m. Central Standard Time, for my next weekly live prophetic word. Okay? Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. And remember, the Holy Ghost is trying to give us seven times. So we don't have to stop on double. We can go all the way up to seven times. And remember, that number seven in English means every possible combination of seven. So let the Holy Ghost tell you what kind of sevens he wants to birth in your life. Amen. And God bless. I will see you Thursday. And if I have new music, it'll be on Friday. And then for the next live prophetic word, I'll see you Sunday. God bless.